in posture therapy, words matter a lot. In my TED talk, I explained that the art of posture is the art of precision over a prolonged duration. Precision in the concepts, precision in the words, precision in the execution. And many of you are misled by imprecise ways of explaining things. In particular, Cameron has sent me an email saying, well, I'm a bit confused with the guidance that I received at work, because on the drawing, which you see here, it seems that the whole back is on the chair, whilst I see on your channel that you say that you should only support the pelvis. So let me clarify this. What happens if you rest your whole back on the chair? Look, what will happen is that, one, I hollow my back. I will remove the headrest, you'll see better. So I hollow my back, and then if I press more behind my shoulder blades, I slide in the seat pan. So you see that pressing your whole back on the backrest is not the point. Yeah? This is when I'm in a neutral sitting posture. There's another way to explain why you only need your pelvis to be on the chair, is that if we observe what happens under the effect of gravity, we see that your pelvis is tilting backwards, and this is bringing with it the rest of the spine, leading to round shoulders posture, head forward, and massive load on the intervertebral discs. So what we want to prevent is this backwards rotation of your pelvis. This is why we only need to lock the pelvis. And you see that when my pelvis is locked, my shoulder blades are not on the backrest. On this chair model, they're very far away because the backrest is shaped in such a way. If you drive your car, especially if it's a sports car, you will have much less space here, in particular for safety reasons. But you should make the difference between pressure that you feel in the lower back area, in the pelvic area, and contact that may happen behind your shoulder blades depending on the shape of the backrest. But contact is not pressure. Now, this is when I work. When I want to rest, of course, and you can see in the description, there's another video on this topic, of course I can rest my whole back on the chair. But you see that here, I need something to hold my head, yeah? Otherwise, these front neck muscles will be super active, and that is the same as continuous forward head posture. So the price to pay, or one of the prices to pay for reclining back, is to have a headrest, i.e. a very high back support, yeah? You definitely need it to go up till your head. The second price to pay when I'm in this position is to not interact directly neither with my screen nor with my keyboard. Why? Because my line of sight is here. So if I want to look at my screen, I'll tend to do this. And why not do anything with my keyboard? Because my hands are actually here at rest. So to bring them on the keyboard, I need to do all this effort, which is what I call in the posture manual a violation of rule number two. Rule number two being the one that states that the neck should always be relaxed. Okay, so this is a perfectly allowable position, provided that you daydream, that you listen to music, that you do a Zoom in which you mainly listen and don't watch at the details of what's happening on your screen, etc. So to conclude, do you need a high backrest on your chair or not? You can have a very low backrest on your chair if it's just a chair for working. And when you don't work, i.e. every 30 minutes at least, you get up. That's perfectly okay. Now, if you want a chair that has a more flexible use pattern that allows you to work but that also allows you to daydream, then you need a high backrest. But in this case, well, you should also have a headrest, because if you don't, reclining back will mean increased load in your neck. So either a very short backrest or a high backrest with an adjustable headrest.